Ik ga ook meteen beginnen, want we hebben heel weinig tijd. Ik ben Ned Scherpenzeel. Ik ben een teammanager bij... Oh, sorry, I have to switch languages. Yes, queen. I'm Ned Scherpenzeel. I'm a teammanager at Statistics Netherlands. And we have organized this session today because we want to show you the treasure of data that we have available at Statistics Netherlands. And that can be used for all sorts of research. The idea for this session came up last year at the last conference, where some of my colleagues, among which was Fatima, who will also present later on, were present, and they noticed that it was not very well known that we have so much data available at Statistics Netherlands.
And dat heb jij.
It can be used.
Dat heb jij.
Ja.
Dit is echt nieuw.
Can you mute yourself? I don't know who's speaking. Yeah. So I was saying in the last year's conference, we noticed that we could improve a little bit how much is known about the data that we have available and what can be done with it. And that's why we organized this session today. We will show you the use of the StatLine tool that we have to find statistics for your research. We will show you also how you can use the register data that we have available at Statistics Netherlands at the micro level. And the final presentation will be an illustration of what you can do with that data, for example, to use it for COVID research. I'm going to switch immediately to the first speaker because I don't want to lose too much time. Lucien, maybe you can already start sharing your screen.
Yes, hopefully it works.
Yeah, and then I will say one more thing before we start to the people present here. I think we will have very little time to answer questions. So my suggestion is that if you have questions during the presentation, please write them in the chat. And then we will try to answer as many of those questions as possible during the session. Okay, the floor is yours, Lucien.
Thank you for your introduction, Annette. Good afternoon, everyone. So my name is Lucien Reichardt. I'm a statistical researcher at Statistics Netherlands in the Health and Care Department. And in this session, I will tell you more about our open database called StatLine, what we have in the field of health and welfare, and how you can use this open database to compile your own table and graphs. Yes, this is a screenshot of our homepage. A topic that receives a lot of attention in the present times is the well-being in times of coronavirus. If you click on that one, this screen will appear. And here you can see already a lot of interest statistics. For example, the mortality per week in our health section. But there are a lot of more statistics which were very interesting during these times of corona. If you're with your mouse on the line during this whole bit, you see the exact numbers like here of the mortality, for example. For now, I will focus on the StatLine open database, and you can find it below the figures. If you click on StatLine, then this screen will appear. StatLine offers a wealth of figures about the Dutch economy and society, and is freely available. It is reliable as well, and it's independently collected by us. I think one of the key messages in this presentation is that we need to say that we have a treasure trove of data at CBS, also about healthcare and welfare. It's often based on registration of the entire population in the Netherlands. Fatima will speak later on about this topic as well. And a major advantage of our data is that you have the option to link data files together. For example, you can link causes of death in combination with hospital admissions, but you can also link healthcare costs in combination with medicines. These are just two random examples. You can link whatever you want. We have a lot of data, and it's all linkable with each other. So that's a really major advantage of our data. This is the flowchart of StatLine. I will take you through the process of finding the correct CBS figures about health and welfare. Your way to finding, sharing, and applying data is very simple. You can search for your topic by theme or keyword, then view the tables, edit them, and translate the table into a graph or a map. And finally, you can save and share it. For now, in the first time, we focus on searching by theme or keyword. So what kind of data do we have in StatLine on the topic health and welfare? First of all, we have statistics about basic insurance, the number of declared healthcare costs, and number of defaulters you need to think about. We have statistics about donor registration, about finance, spendings, and employment. We have statistics about health life expectancy. For example, if you want to know if a what is the life expectancy of a person if he has not reported any physical disabilities or chronic illnesses, for example. A lot of data about health and use of care. You need to think about GP care, medicines, mental health care, youth service, long-term care, specialist medical care. So a lot of topics on this one. Domestic violence, we have also statistics about lifestyle and prevention. Then you need to think about weight, smoking, alcohol, food, nutrition, etc. Birth, perinatal, and infant mortality data. Deaths and causes of death. So for example, the difference between natural and versus non-natural death. Work and health. Then you need to think about working conditions, absenteeism, working impediment, and last but not least, also data about welfare. And then you need to think about satisfaction in work, for example, education, finance, living, and social life, for example. So how can we find this? Every put a link on it so you can see it later on as well by yourself, because I think the presentation will be online as well. You click on it, you go to Studline. So this is our homepage of Studline. Then click to theme, but it's interesting because now my screen sharing is in front of the theme, so make a bit, look like this. Go on themes, and then you go to health and welfare, and then you have the topics here as well. I need to say you need to be aware not every table in Studline is already trans. My cat is here in the house. And it's not already translated in English. So if you go to the Dutch Studline, then there's more options because, as I said, not everything is translated, and hopefully in the future, every table is translated. If you go to a sub-theme, you see another table. Okay, we'll go back to the presentation. So we have a lot of data, that's the conclusion. If you go back to our flowchart, in the second phase, so we found our table, and now we want to view it and we want to translate it to a chart or a map, and finally we can save and share it. For example, we went to the table about medical specialist care, and you see this is a default presentation of our of the table. Every table has its own default presentation. It's possible to change the content of the table as well as the layout of the table. You can select items in the table that are interesting to you. So this is done by using filters. For example, if you want to change the diagnose, you can click on the filter icon and this screen will appear. Then you can choose by yourself, for example, your diagnose where you're interested to. So a short live session as well, this. So we go to the Studline table. For example, I want to have another specialism. For example, I'm interested in ENT, so KNO or surgery as well. You click them, select them, you check, and then you will see the first seven are about ENT tables and the rest is about surgery. If you say, okay, it's too much, I'm now just interested in ENT, deselect surgery, and you'll get this. So you can select whatever you want. That's the thing what I want to say. Besides selecting, you can also adjust the layout. And what does it mean? On every table, in every table, you see this information on top. Variables can be dragged to the header, rows, or columns of the table. And in the header, only one item of a variable can be selected. In some cases, selection in a presentation of the table is placed above the gray line, so like above this gray line. For example, in this case, leeftijd, so age. This means that for this selection, only one item is shown in the table, in this case, total. To show all age groups, you need to drag it down to the table, so adjust the layout. So we'll let's show this as well. So if you are interested in age groups, you see if I can drag it to different positions. For example, I drag it to this one. And what I say, I was interested in the different age groups instead of the total. I select them and there's a really big table. So I'm not interested in the characteristics at the moment. So I'm dragging them and the type of institution. And then you see here all the age groups, different age groups. So that's what you can do. You can also place it on this way. You can drag it everywhere and make your own tables in your own layout. Besides the table presentation, we also have a graphical presentation. So then this one is on. So it's the blue means that it's active. This is a screenshot of the number of deceased persons in the Netherlands, broken down by gender and age per week. The pattern is, here you can see our first COVID-19 peak in Q1 2020. And then you see from here onwards, the number increase again, but to a lesser extent than in Q1. This one, this visible decrease at the end of 2020 is due to the fact that the week the last week consists of only 4 days, so week 53. So it's not representative in comparison with the other weeks. Here as well, you can select whatever you want. And in the end, you can download the image like here and you can use it for data. So this was the thing about open data. So all statistics are published in our data bank Statline. We've put all the links, so the Dutch one and the English. Also available in our open data portal, so you have the link there. If you have any questions about Statline open data, we have an info service, you can click on it. All other questions, you can contact me or put your question in the chat. Thank you very much. And then I'll stop sharing, I think. Like this, yeah.
Thank you very much. As I said, if you have questions, please put them in the chat. Or maybe we'll have some time at the end of the three presentations, but for the moment, I want to continue with the next presenter. Thanks a lot, Lucien. Next presenter is Fatima El-Misakli, also from Statistics Netherlands, and she will present to you how you can actually use the register data themselves with our microdata services. Floor is yours, but you're on mute, Fatima.
I'll mute myself. Yeah. Thank you very much, Annette. Yes, I'm Fatima Maslaki, and I'm working as an account manager at Microdata Services. And as Annette mentioned, I'm going to explain to you how you can do your own research within the remote access environment. As Lucien already showed and mentioned, we publish figures on topics that are of interest to everyone in our Statline database. We collect this information from different registers, like the population registers, but also the income registers from tax authorities and so on. But we also gather very interesting and more detailed information from questionnaires, like the health surveys, which are very informative as well. Because this information on an aggregated level is not always suitable for research, microdata are needed. And these microdata are linkable data at the level of individuals, of companies and institutions, and which may, according to the Statistical Netherlands Act 41, can be made available to authorized institutions. Of course, under strict conditions for the statistical research. The guiding principle here is safeguarding privacy and preventing disclosure of persons and companies. And then in the Statistics Netherlands Act, there's also a section about the citizen service number, which is also known as the BSN number, that allows us to get information, whether it's sensitive or not, for statistical purposes. Of course, because of this, it's extremely important to safeguard the privacy of individuals and companies as we process and publish all these data. And before we publish them, we always check whether there's any information which might be traceable to these individuals or companies. If that's the case, of course, we don't publish them at all. So what can we offer you at Microdata Services? You can do your own research within a secure remote access environment. I will explain to you later on how that works, but it's only available to do research on statistical research and not for administrative or control purposes against individuals or institutions. And there are some conditions that must be met before you can do your research within the RA environment. And of course, costs are involved. Well, this is how the remote access environment looks like. I'm not sure if you can see the mouse. Can you see it? Okay. Yes. You can analyze the microdata, CBS microdata, via a secure internet connection. So it's your own internet connection. And you will receive a personal hardware token with a SMS code to be able to log into the system. So you will only have here the access to the data which are needed for your own research. So you're not going to get all the data we have here. And we will provide you with a secure working environment in which you can store the draft versions, the syntaxes, and the output. And all the microdata will remain within this secure environment. And when you have the results like ready for publication, then we will first have them checked before you can get the outputs on an aggregated level via the email on your own computer. And then you can, of course, publish it via a presentation or article. There's also the possibility to upload your own data sets, like data with patients. I will explain to you how you can do that. Before you can do that, we must assess whether the uploaded data set fits the purpose limitation of the study. And we check with you if the acquisition of the data set and also the delivery thereof to CBS is legitimate. So if that's the case and these conditions are met and also the key variable within your data set can be used to encrypt the data, you can upload it within a upload, which is a secure upload portal. And then we will receive the data and encrypt it, pseudonymize it, and place it within the remote access environment. Yeah, well, this also involves removal of the directly identifying data, of course. And note that the uploaded data will only be available within your own project environment. So it won't be available for other projects within the remote access. As soon as we are sure that the pseudonymization is done correctly, we remove the original data set that's uploaded within the upload portal. So we will not use this for our own statistical purposes, of course. Well, Lucien has already given you some examples of data sets, and I will give you an example of different health data sets that are used within the remote access environment. And we have these data on an individual level, like the cancer registrations, the causes of death, but also the hospital admissions. And some of them with the asterisks are uploaded by, like in this example, by IKNL or Polga, but there are also some other data sets which are already available within the remote access environment, like the hospital admissions. For these kind of data, sometimes permission is required from the owner of the data. So you can do your research on by focusing on persons, but it's also possible to look at households instead of that. Or in the case of studies about children, you can also look at the parents by looking at the population data sets and see whether who are the parents of a kid or a child with some diseases. Another study that shows how linking different data sets can produce a very nice analysis file is the study of the food poisoning Salmonella and colon cancer study. The researchers of this study uploaded more data sets a data set from RIVM that contains information about individuals who suffered from food poisoning like Salmonella, and also another data set that contains the individuals who that are diagnosed with colon cancer, and also another data set from POLGA, which contained the pathology records of these patients. And they linked this data to other CBS data here, that like the date of death and also some other demographic and economic data sets, in order to check whether people with a history of severe food poisoning by Salmonella may also have an increased risk of colon cancer. And it's of course very interesting and nice that this is going to be all done within the remote access environment. Well, this is another example of a research that can be done within the remote access environment, like a COVID-19 study. By looking at the cause of death, you can select all the people who have died from COVID-19. And you can then link these people to other health data that are available in the Statistics Netherlands catalog. Or you can also upload your own data set. In this case, there's another project that will start. I think it's already started, the GGD, which uploaded a data set with the test results of the COVID-19. And they want to look at different data sets within the remote access environment to explain the effects of COVID-19. You can also look go even further by looking at, for example, the social the social economic effects or regional effects to explain the differences between people who get COVID-19. I'm afraid I have to skip this one because I'm not sure. Do we have time, Annette?
Have one more minute.
One more minute. Okay, this is more for the bigger data set that needs a supercomputer, which is can be made available by SURF and Odyssey. If you have any questions about this, please contact me another time. Because we don't have time to go through all the data sets we offer, I would like to refer to you our website where you can find our catalog and also some other data sets and also some more practical information about how to start your project can be found here. Like this workflow where we explain how to start your project by do an application for the authorization of your institution and then prepare for your project and then output checking and publishing your results. Some interesting publications already done within the remote access environment are given here, but you can also find some projects that are already started within on our website. So please check that. If you have any questions, please put them in the chat box and I will be happy to answer them for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Fatima. There were some questions in the chat. I answered one of them and we'll look at the others later on also. Thanks a lot. For now, I would like to continue immediately to the third speaker, Willem Lijvering. This speaker is not from Statistics Netherlands. Willem is from the LUMC. But he is one of our users. He used the microdata services that Fatima just presented to do his research, and we'll tell about that and how that was.
Okay,
of course, yours, Willem.
Thank you for the introduction. I think that you can see my screen, right? Or okay, thank you. So I'm from the LMC. I'm a clinical epidemiologist, and I was asked to tell a little bit about COVID research in CBS. And I'd like to take the opportunity to thank CBS because we don't see each other that often. We only see each other by mail. I just like to say that the data that you have is awesome, and that you can do lots of things with it. And one of the things is COVID research. And I'll show you what we did with COVID research in the last year. So, of course, for that, I'd like to get back to last year, March, April. There were a couple of problems then, you all know it. There was a lockdown, there was uncertainty, unclarity, and about the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And we were thinking, what can we do? And we thought, well, we can ask a couple of questions in CBS, even at the time, even though COVID was not available, data available in CBS at the time. And we thought about three things. If COVID-19 is more deadly than influenza, if COVID-19 spread similarly to influenza during a mass gathering event, and you know how influenza spreads, you know, in general among a population. And those three questions were all asked, but only one is currently published. So I would like to stick with the published one that's easier to talk about. And it's an interesting one, I think, about how COVID-19 spreads, if it's similar to influenza during a mass gathering event, that is carnival. The publication is here, very proud of it. It was published last year, I think in September or something. And the research question was actually this: if the change in transmission patterns of influenza and COVID-19 before and after carnival in the Netherlands changed. And for that, we used a couple of data sets. We used CBS microdata, we used Statline, open data, and we also used information from the RIVM about COVID-19 data, basically, because at that time, COVID-19 data was publicly available, but only through RIVM. I'm not sure if it's now available also through CBS, but for influenza, we had the data was at least present. So that's what we did. So we looked at influenza epidemic in 2017-2018 in carnival regions and non-carnival regions. And then we did something similar with COVID-19 in carnival regions and non-carnival regions. And what we basically wanted to look at is how the disease was developing, you know, over time, before and after carnival. Now you may ask why the 2017-2018 flu epidemic? Well, there were two reasons actually for that epidemic. One was that it was the worst influenza epidemic of at least the last 20 years in the Netherlands, according to RIVM. So there were many, we expected to find many people with influenza in CBS. That was one reason, so we had lots of numbers. And the second also important reason was that the 2018 flu epidemic occurred at the same time when carnival was happening. And this is not true for every year, so we also looked at other years, but other years maybe the flu, the peak of the epidemic already was passed before carnival was there, or sometimes there was no flu epidemic at all in some years. So we decided to only look at 2017-2018 for that reason. And so when we talk about carnival, so this is basically also open source data. We just took it from Google, from a website where they said that you celebrate carnival. And of course, there can be a discussion about it, but I think it's mainly true. I mean, it's mainly done in Limburg, Noord-Brabant, and then some regions in Twente and Gelderland. Basically, so that's how we defined carnival with non-carnival. And then we had to have some outcome definitions and how we defined, you know, our study endpoint. And this is the most important slide for this talk, so that you also understand what CBS microdata has. So we went to CBS first, and we asked for in the microdata, we looked at diagnosis of flu influenza admitted to hospital, because that's the data that CBS had. So it's not everybody with influenza, but it's just everybody with influenza who visited the hospital, and there were scored, and they were scored with an ICD-10 code, and we looked at those codes, and then we basically just scored influenza cases. You know, data sets that they are sometimes problematic. There's, you know, they're large data sets, so there can be some errors in it, random errors mainly, usually, maybe only. But you know, we saw some errors, maybe that we saw a couple of people, they had many influenza diagnoses over time. And you know, when you saw that, could be true, but probably an error. And then we said, you know, we just take the first diagnosis, or when there were more than 30 days, then we said, okay, then this person may have had two diagnoses. And there were also some cases that of which we could not define the region, very few. I don't know exactly why, but maybe they were very rural areas or something, and then we didn't know the area. It was less than 0.2%. So it was basically everybody in the Netherlands, and then we could see influenza over time. And for COVID-19, we did something similar, but that we did not do with CBS data, but we did it with RIVM data. that was published on CoronaWatch. And we were lucky that the RVM published data on COVID from the start of the epidemic at the end of February 2020 per region. And they stopped doing that in March 2020 onwards, at least at the time when we did the analysis. Maybe it changed, but that was at the time. And in fact, that was actually a very good timing for us, because as you also may remember, is that, you know, in March, only patients who were sick and were very sick and had to go to hospital were basically tested for whether they had COVID or not. So, and when they had COVID, they were admitted. So in that way, we had two groups who were kind of comparable, you know, in terms of virus disease, viral disease, viral respiratory disease, influenza for which you were admitted, and a viral disease, COVID-19, for which you were admitted. And in that way, we could, you know, well, we looked at it and see, you know, is there any difference between, you know, the spreading of the disease? Now, the baseline results, it's kind of interesting. You see a lot of interesting results here. And we could have taken this information from microdata, but it was also available in Statline, open source. So we just took it from Statline. It was easier for us, went faster. And we just looked at region, carnival region, non-carnival region. And what you can see here mainly is that the regions are comparable in terms of, you know, average age, urbanity, family income, or family family home, marital status. And maybe the carnival region, the people were a little bit older, slightly older, but for the rest, it's kind of comparable. And an interesting aspect I thought from this table is if you go to the results that we're going to in a minute, is that in 2018, when there was a large flu epidemic, that the mortality rate over a year time was the same in both regions. And I'll show you in a minute that flu occurred more often in the carnival region. So what this means that even though flu occurred more in the carnival region, that at the end of the year, the number of deaths were the same in both populations, which I think is an interesting finding, which is true for flu. So what are our main results? So how does it look like? Well, it looked like this. So you have here for influenza, you see on the x-axis, you see the time when the epidemic occurred from October 2017 till May 2018, then the epidemic was over. And in the yellow line or in the orange line, you see the carnival period. And what you can see is that, you know, the spread of COVID cases on the y-axis per 100,000 inhabitants, you see it's basically the same for the carnival region and the non-carnival region. And then a couple of days after carnival occurred, you see a surge in influenza cases in the carnival region and not in the non-carnival region. So that's how
I have to warn you that you have slightly more than 1 minute left.
1 minute, okay. So I do the rest in 1 minute. So you see that all, huh? And you see the same for COVID.
Maybe one and a half.
And you see the same for COVID-19. So there are some things that I would like to say about this research, and it's also for CBS in general, that if you look at diagnosis, it's electronic data, so you have to kind of assume that the data is correct. It's difficult. There are ways to see if it's correct or not, but you're never sure. I could talk about endless about confounding and epidemiology, I like confounding, but I don't think there was lots of confounding. You know, the characteristics between the regions were similar. We did what is called an instrumental variable analysis, which means that, you know, we assumed that everybody in the carnival region celebrated carnival and in a non-carnival region didn't. That's of course not entirely true, but it's about true, I think. And we didn't look at differences in how carnival was celebrated. You know, there could be all sorts of ways. We didn't really have the data. We didn't look at it. And, you know, I just keep this up for maybe for some discussion, but I think in general, I think it's interesting CBS data. We just did this as an example study, but if you just look at our method, if you just look at regional if you want to look at regional differences, you can do it with CBS. But you could also look at, you know, differences in employment and diseases in CBS and so on and so on. And since I'm out of time, I would like to stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Will. I'm sorry for having to interrupt you, but we got this warning also from the system that we might, and I was afraid we would be thrown out of the session. So formally this session ends now, but I think if we're not thrown out and people still do want to post questions to one of the presenters, I will give the opportunity now. I've seen some questions in the chat that I tried to answer. Okay, I was afraid again we were thrown out, but it seems we're not. So if people have to leave for another session, I would suggest they do. But if you want to now have questions to the three presenters, then I will give the floor to you. So does anyone want to pose a question? I don't know. If you want to pose a question, then put on your camera and your mic and just start talking, because I can't see you otherwise. And if there are no questions, then I would really like to thank the three speakers very much, Willem, Fatima, and Lucien, and thank you all for participating in the session.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.